chapter 14, entitled The Forest of Enjoyment, text 24. Speaking of the nature of people's infatuation for wealth. Sometimes one can have a unique perspective of things if you're not involved. If you can see it from a neutral perspective. Shukadeva Swami, he was living in the forest. He didn't have a house. He didn't have a wife or children. He didn't have any possessions. He didn't even have clothes. Some yogis were extremely renounced. The only cloak, the only possession they have is their kopan, their loincloth, and their water pot. Shukadeva Goswami neither had a water pot or a kopan. He had literally nothing. Imagine living like that. And he never kept anything, even a minute. Sometimes at least keep a bowl so in your bag you have something to collect. For him, even a bowl was unnecessary opulence. He would go to the house of somebody who was in the morning and they were milking their cow, and he would just, and they would get their own bowl, milk the cow. And then right out of the cow, Shukadeva Goswami would drink it, get the bowl back, and leave. Since he wouldn't even stay in one place longer than it took to milk the cow. Always wondering. Other people, and even though they may not own anything, you know, official property in their main possessions, but they become attached to a certain situation here, there a long time. Like it may be a tree in the forest, nobody owns it, but I'm living under the tree. This is my tree. And Shukadeva Swami, he never slept under the same tree twice. He's always moving from one place to another. He couldn't call anything his country, he couldn't call this is my forest, because he was in a different forest all. And he did this very purposely. You read when he was in the womb of his mother, he had realized Brahma. He realized the all-pervading, impersonal aspect of the Supreme Lord. He self-realized. And he understood all the dualities of this world and how they impact people in so many ways. So he decided, I'm just going to stay here. I don't want to see that. I don't want to see those attractions that just cause suffering. He did tell us, Ehi samspada shajan bhoga dukha yonaya evadeya yandavam dukhondaya na teshu ramadeya. The definition of intelligence in this verse is one who does not get attracted to the sources of misery, which are the pleasures of this world. Quite a deep concept. So since Shukadeva Goswami, there's not much pleasure in the womb of a mother. Can't see it. There's no life. You have the pupil of your eyes are good, you can't see anything. You can't really eat anything. Tongue likes things, where all of your food's coming in through your navel. So you can't taste anything with your tongue. You can't eat anything, see anything. Probably doesn't smell very good in there. Life in the womb. This is until I die naturally, I'm just going to stay here. And you can't move. You know, sometimes if you're on an airplane, seatbelt, economy class, just push this plane. You can't walk around in your purpose room, especially when he's already 12 years old. He was taking up every bit of space for him. It was really crowded in. And in there, he was finding peace and happiness within himself. He didn't want to be distracted from that. But then he heard about Krishna. Krishna actually attracted his heart. When he heard the pastimes of Krishna and connected with Krishna, he understood this is a higher experience, a greater ecstasy than peace. Love is higher than peace. So he came out of the womb to hear more about Krishna. And then his whole conception was different. He didn't just see everything in the world as an illusion that distracts him. He saw everything in the world as Krishna's energy. But he was just observing it and didn't want to be trapped by the tendency to think that this is mine. He wanted to keep fully the consciousness that everything is proprietor, and he's the enjoyer. And he was just wandering around. And not only from the physical perspective did he have absolutely nothing to the extreme degree. But he understood that there's subtle baggage that can completely distract your attention. And that was becoming famous. Because there are six opulences that Krishna possesses in full to an unlimited degree forever. And those opulences are the same very opulences that people love to have in this world. Because if you have any one of these opulences to a larger degree than others, then you become attracted. Aishwaryasya, Samagrasya, Priyasya, Vishashriya. People become attractive if they're beautiful, if they have wealth, if they have strength, just like these Olympics going on in London. It's really a sign of how people get mixed up. Because I was just in London. And before I went to London, I was in the United States, everybody who heard I was going to London, they were saying, oh, this is a bad time, it's so crowded, there's so much traffic, there's so many people, it's going to be really terrible there. So I was thinking, Sukadeva Goswami doesn't care about that stuff. So I have some service there, so whatever traffic and everything, I'll go. So I went to do my service, and I was thinking there's going to be congestions everywhere, people everywhere. And you know something? I was there right at the heart of the Olympics. Even in the opening ceremonies in London, I never saw London so peaceful. It's not because of transcendental vision. It's because there's hardly anyone around. It was incredible. We could drive around. There's always massive traffic in London, except now. The reason is they made so much propaganda to keep people away because they were thinking there was going to be masses of floods of people. And and it was going to be traffic jams that were intolerable. So this propaganda that the British government was putting out, you know, don't come unless you really, you know, have a purpose, because you're going to really be inconvenienced. And because of the propaganda, nobody came. Everybody was afraid to come because it would be too crowded. And all the people who were in the Olympics, they were afraid to come to downtown London because they were in East London, because it was going to be too crowded in downtown. So everybody in the Olympics stayed in the East and nobody else came. And the taxi drivers were like really, really disturbed because no one was taking taxis, because no one was around. And all the shopkeepers were very, very outraged because no one was shopping. And they bought extra because they were preparing massive crowds of people everywhere. And Swamis like me were driving to our program. They even had on every road practically, they reserved a particular lane all over the city with these five circles. And that lane is reserved for the athletes and the press for the Olympics. And anybody, and you have to have a car that has all these Olympics decorations on it. And if you're caught on that lane without an Olympic car, then you're going to get arrested. Everyone was thinking, the traffic, and whole lanes are reserved for Olympics, the traffic's going to be miserable. Some of the places I was going, there were more cars in the Olympic lanes than all the athletes. And that was only an athlete or two. They wanted to try to solve one problem, but in the problem of trying to solve one problem, they created a bigger problem. But again, that's not for a lot of talk. Solutions sometimes cause bigger problems than others. So Shukadeva Goswami, he's just saying everything is Krishna's property. And he's six opulences we're talking about make a person attractive. And this is how powerful Maya is at every step. Because Krishna tells in Gita, Daivi Vrishya Guna Maya Mama Maya Duratya. Mama Maya Duratya means Maya. This external energy comprised of the three modes of nature is Maya energy. This material energy is working under Maya control. So Maya is Krishna's energy. That means she is all powerful. She's super intelligent. She knows everything. Like the Paramatma knows everything about you, Maya knows everything about you. She has such intelligence agency. If you want to defeat somebody, the more you know about them, the more you know their strengths, their weaknesses. So Maya knows everything. She knows everything you've ever done. She knows what you think. She knows what you like. She knows what you don't like. And she's there to get you. Is that scary? The problem with you Western people is you do not have enough fear of Maya. You're supposed to be afraid of her. You're not afraid of Maya. She's definitely going to capture us and we won't even know it. But the fear of Maya should not just make us schizophrenic, paranoia people in depression. Our fear of Maya should make us happy. Because our fear of Maya, like that little baby who cried last night, fear of Maya should make us take shelter of Krishna with whole heart, with a single-minded purpose. Yadashaya atmaka bhuhir ekeha kudana. Ekeha. O those who are on this path are resolute in purpose, and their aim is one. They are not irresolute. Because we understand how my work is, how comprehensive and complete she is, and her keeping us in illusion. And we understand that we have no power against her. However great we are, however intelligent we are, however many verses we memorize, however many Brahmins we chant, however strictly following others, however many temples we build, why is too strong? Even as devotees, what we know how to do good, she'll use that to defeat us. That's how comprehensive and thorough I am. So when we understand that, we have a healthy fear of Maya. And we understand Mamavaya Dhabhati. That Krishna is the controller of Maya. If we surrender to Krishna, that beautiful verse from the Bhagavad Gita, Samasi, that Maya is like an ocean. And all the illusions are like the waves of the ocean. And how many waves are on an ocean? And the waves of the ocean, they're always changing, adjusting, and readjusting according to the water. And varied, but this is a different kind of ocean. This ocean has no bottom. And has no shore. Now, somebody just took you on a private charter jet airplane and took you to the very, very middle point of the Atlantic Ocean. Said, all right, this is your stop. Push it off. We have like about 2,000 miles on one side and 2,000 miles on all four sides of just water. What can you do? Start swimming. Your little arms are about this big and your feet are kicking about this big. And there's sharks and there's whales and there's barracudas and there's eels and there's jellyfish and all kinds of things all around you. And you have about 2,000 miles to swim to the ocean. And it's freezing. What is your hope? Well, that's kind of the way we are in the material world. Except the shore's not just 2,000 miles, which is impossible. There is no shore. It's just ocean forever. But the Bhagavad Gita explains if you take shelter of Murari, Krishna, then that vast ocean of water, it becomes reduced to the amount of water contained in a hoofprint in a calf. So you have some nice little calves here. Now even a cow. Only about this big. And a calf is only about this big. A calf footprints are all like this. Why doesn't the Bible kind of at least give Maya the credit to say a cow's footprint? Maya, the significance of Maya is Maya. No, Maya is really interesting. A calf's footprint. Calf's tiny little footprint. That's through Krishna's grace. That is Krishna's power. In our Bhagavatam 10th canto explains how Krishna works. It describes there that those who are trying to cross the ocean of material existence by their own wealth, by their own intelligence, by their own strength, by their own gifts, beauty by their own efforts. I like people who are trying to cross the ocean on a boat made out of solid rock. Well, some people, they carve, they get the best designers, you know, Michelangelo, Raphael, and all these people carving the rocks. Carving the rock, the stone boat. So it looks very nice. It may be worth $1 billion to carve the type of stone. But it really doesn't make that much difference, right? Whether it's just simple rock or hand carved, pure marble, Venice, Italy. It's the same. But it describes those who take shelter of Krishna. Do you know how they cross the ocean? The lotus feet of the Lord are like a boat. And you just walk across the water. Here's the ocean of material existence. You just go on this little boat of Krishna's lotus feet that you take shelter of, and you walk across the boat and you're on the other side. And the boat doesn't move, it just stays where it is. And you call other people. And everybody who follows you can just walk across the boat to where on the other side. It's spiritual. How is it that the boat works that way? Because by Krishna's grace, when you take shelter of them, the ocean reduces to an insignificant quantity. Sukadeva Goswami, he has a very objective perspective of how people are living in the fever of trying to get ahead in this material world, trying to find security, and trying to find relief from all the expectations and demands and everything else. But Maya suffering. But if you understand all those things and you become detached, oh, this person likes to be detached. I got it. I got it now. Whew, she goes right into your heart. And she gets you attached to being detached. That's one of the opulences, renunciation. Six primary happiness is renunciation. Give up your attachment to wealth and strength and beauty and all these things, but then you become attached to your renunciation. And ego, it feeds your ego. You're thinking, I eat less than him. I get up early in the morning. I have less saris than her. I don't wear jewelry. My bed is harder than you. Attracted to our renunciation. And what does that mean? We're just puppets of Maya. That's all. Maya's little clowns making fools of ourselves in the name of being staunch sadhus. She has this. You know, some fish who have the hook right down into their heart, pulling them. It's like, you know, the fisherman kind of just lets the string get a little, maybe release some, so there's more room. So the fish is swimming around thinking, just see how free I am. The hook's right there, the core of his heart.
yourself free? Come on, go on. Come on. Tell everybody what a great saint you are, what a great devotee you are, what a great Vaishnava you are. Go on. Accept puja and all that stuff. And then now, yes, yes. And then. Sukadeva Goswami, he understood that even prestige, recognition for being renounced is just as much a distraction and form of bondage as being attached to things. Being proud of one's detachment is another type of attachment. So, not only did he have nothing, but he behaved in a way that everybody thought he was just a disgusting fool. Pretty detached. He wasn't going to villages saying, I give you my self-analyzed enlightened blessings, everyone around here. He would just look around like, people would look at him and say, he's crazy, get this guy out of here, he's naked, he's crazy, he's one of those dysfunctional Hare Krishna people. Parasite, why don't you get a job, Sukadeva? Okay. He describes in the Bhagavatam, who would harass him? Even stupid people, intelligent people could understand what he wants and who he wants. But most people are not intelligent. They would throw stones at him, they would pass air in front of him, they would sometimes throw stool at him, and he didn't object. He was just like, oh, thank you. just like, I'm stupid. We're insulting him, we're throwing obnoxious objects on him. We're harassing him, and he's like. So even when he was shown the highest level of detachment, they interpreted that as insanity. And he purposely acted like this so that nobody would praise him. Until Parikshit Maharaj was sitting on the bank of the Ganga. Place is still there. That is called Shukada, the actual place from where Bhagavatam is spoken. So Sukadeva Goswami went there. And all the common people were following him around and harassing him. Then he comes to the place where Narada Muni and Parvat Muni and Vishwamitra Muni and Gautam Rishi and all these great sages, Akshay Muni, they're all assembled. The greatest saints, sages, rishis, and yogis in the whole universe are gathered together to be with Sukadeva Goswami. And they're all deciding who should be the one who speaks? For 7 days, you know, sometimes at this time you want to give everyone the chance to speak. And everybody's getting their chance, but the poor people are thinking, God, what's next? You've read that experience. You have to give everybody a chance to speak. There's 20 people and they're out, you know, speaking, you're out going overtime. The people in the audience are saying, you know, where's Prasad? Everybody's speaking on something else. It's hard to focus. Of course it's nice, but still. In this situation, they were all there. They all had amazing things to speak, but they were trying to just have one person focus, speak, and give a comprehensive talk. Who? And here, Shukadeva was walking through the forest naked. People are harassing him, and children are spitting on him, laughing at him. He's not saying, I am the son of Yas. He's just looking at him. He was happy. You see, when he was getting infamy and dishonor, he was thinking, this is opulence. There's nothing but Krishna in this situation. It's not attractive. It's not attractive, these things. So when things that are not attractive to us happen, we can take shelter of what's attractive, Krishna. Otherwise, if things attractive happen to us, our tendency is to take shelter of that. And then we don't think Krishna. Sorry if I'm getting too psychological today. But this chapter is very psychological, actually. So here's all these people chasing after him and making ridiculing him, and they think he's just a fool. And human nature is you like to harass people who are less than you. You like to see people less than you, so you can think you're great. And then they came into this assembly of the greatest rishis, sages in the whole universe, and the king of the world, the emperor, sitting there. And they all stood up to receive Shukadeva Swami. They all honored him. And people were chasing after him. God, you know, he's no fun anymore. Let's get out of here. They left. And they sat Shukadeva Swami on Vyasa Swami. And his father, Vyasadeva, is there. The compiler of the depth of Vedic literature. So Mondaymorning, his guru, is there. And all these sages, Vishishta Muni, the guru of Ramchandra, and they're all sitting at the feet of Shukadeva Goswami, who was only 16 years old at the time. He came out of the womb of his mother when he was about 12, and he was just traveling around like a madman for 4 years, and now here he is, giving the most famous lecture in the history of the world. Sukadeva Goswami is explaining the nature of the material world from a very, very neutral perspective, just seeing everything from within and without. And here he's describing how in the forest of enjoyment, people steal, and then other people steal from them, and then other people steal from them. And Srila Prabhupada likes to quote Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati. He really just had, I guess what they would call in modern times, cutting edge analogies, just explaining what's happening. And Srila Prabhupada quotes that a gang of thieves, they go, they break into somebody's house, they beat them, steal everything from the house. Then they go back to the forest hideout. And one of the thieves said to the other thieves, let us divide this up honestly. It's called honesty among thieves. So they have their own culture of honesty. And they'll punish each other. Somebody gets even more than another. We have to do this very honestly. But the problem is, you know, what they're trying to honestly organize and manage has all been gotten dishonest. Honor among thieves. from Sukadeva Goswami's perspective, Krishna says in Vita Sarva Loka Maheshwara, that everything is the faculty of Bhagavan, of the Supreme Lord. And if we claim anything to be our own, we're a thief. And we're making all kinds of laws and we're creating all kinds of cultures, to be honest, in how we deal with it. But we've stolen, and then somebody steals from us. That's the way the world goes. Jiva, jiva, sajivanam. The strong exploit the weak. So if we have the power, we'll take from somebody else, and then somebody who's stronger than us is going to try to take it from us, and then somebody who's stronger than them is going to try to take it from them. And in this way, what's really steady? And ultimately, death takes everything away. Doesn't leave you with a single euro. You may work hard, or we may work hard in our life to get a big property, because property is a stable investment. You know, you put money in the stock market or the bank, you don't know what's going to happen to money. But property is stable. So you get a big property, 10,000 acres of prime real estate. It's in your name, there's no mortgage, there's no contracts, it is completely legally yours. That's a great accomplishment. But then when you die, you cannot take a single blade of grass with you. Cannot take a single grain of with you. It's $11. Proprietorship means control. If you want to borrow the tongue, gives it an example. Just like the honey bee. There's so many bees. These little bees, they really work hard. In America, when I was young, there was a saying, you should work like a bee. You shouldn't stay like a bee, but you should work like a bee. Because bees are really hard. They're constantly, they go out of their hive and they just go and search for pollen, these little pollens, and they come back and bring it to the hive, and then they go out and they get it again and bring it. They're constantly bringing it. Maybe thousands of them just bringing, and the extent of their whole life, from when they're little children to when they're like really old, they don't even retire, they just keep working and working and working until they die. Yes, and they're working. And they're creating a hive where there's honey. And then the beekeeper, the old human, just comes. After they work their whole life to collect the honey, the beekeeper comes and just takes all the honey, just gets all the bees away and takes the honey, takes it home, puts it in jars and sells it. And the bees are like, all life of work, and they don't even have a drop of honey to show. Yes? And then if somebody comes in and robs the honey from the honeykeeper, and he says, why are you stealing my honey? The Prabhupada quotes Prahlad Maharaj, that for a materialist peace person, money is sweeter than honey. Maybe in the form of property, maybe in the form of our skills, our intelligence, the destiny in the form of the beekeeper comes and takes it all away. And we're just Prabhupada is here saying that Lakshmi's name is Chanchala, which means she's always moving. She never stays in one place. But there is one place she never leaves, the loving service of Narayana. So if we just understand that Lakshmi is happy with Narayana, and we can have so much property, we can have so much beauty, we can have so much opulences, whether it's our beauty or our knowledge or our strength or our fame or our renunciation or our wealth, whatever it may be. If we just use it in the service of the Lord without this false ego of wanting to be the proprietor, the controller, the enjoyer, then we can be liberated, even with all the stuff. When Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was traveling in South India, he came to the house of the Kurma Brahma. In a place called Kurma Kshetra. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he was a Swamiji. All he had was Nityananda already threw his dund in the river, so all he had was his water pot and an extra set of clothes. And he had Kala Krishnadas carrying that for him, and he was intoxicated with the holy name, living such a simple life, just traveling, walking barefoot, thousands of miles. And he came to Kurma Kshetra, and there's a famous Kurma temple. How many have been to Kurma Kshetra? Very special, very holy place. And Ramanuja Sampradaya is very, very special pilgrimage site. And there's the temple of Kurma there, very ancient. The Lord Chaitanya was in, there's just little villages around. He started dancing in front of the form of Kurmadeva, Krishna. And soon the word spread that this beautiful sannyasi would go in. Weeping and ecstatic, love, chant, dancing. Soon, hundreds of people were there to watch him. And soon, thousands, entire villages were coming to see this form of Mahaprabhu. And he was in such compassion. His love of Krishna was pouring out of his heart through his tears, through his voice, through his every gesture of his body. Bhakti dancing is not just like trying to attract people to our bodies. Dancing is not just a way of enjoying movement. In bhakti, every movement of our body during dancing is an offering of our sincere desire to love and to please Krishna. It's a meditation. So Lord Chaitanya, his dancing was not only for the pure pleasure of Radha Krishna, the mood of Radha, but the complexion of Radha, dancing for the pleasure of Krishna. But his dancing was to attract the whole world to dance for Krishna, to experience that. So he would say, Hari Bol, Hari Bol, chant Hari. Thousands of people were chanting and dancing. And after inundating the area with Harinam and Krishna praying, Dr. Raj Goswami says, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he came, he made a garland. He made a garland of the flowers, Harinam Kirtan, on the string of Krishna Prema, and he came to put this garland around the whole world with his own loving, beautiful hand. This is Lord Shiva. So one Brahmin, Kurma, named Kurma, invited him to his house. And Kurma Brahma was so happy cannot calculate how fortunate I am. The same feet that Brahma and Shiva and all the sages and rishis are aspiring to meditate upon, those same 2 feet, the feet that Lakshmi Devi is eager to serve, they are in my home. Today I consider my body, my life, my wealth, my family, my everything to be perfectly successful. Because you have come here to accept my service. And then he said, I am suffering miserably due to the waves of material suffering. I want to leave this world and come with you. Sounds nice. Sometimes when people say, I want to leave everything and join, we say, oh, very nice, very nice. Sometimes it is very nice. But we have to understand time, place, and service. Kurma Brahman was going to leave his family, his children, and join Lord Chaitanya because he said, I cannot tolerate the waves of material miseries anymore. And he was a wealthy man. And he had a really pious, loving family. He had everything everybody wants, but he was still suffering. And because of his intelligence, he realized there's no way out. I'm just going to leave it all. And he obviously thought that those words of renunciation were going to make Lord Chaitanya wait. But Lord Chaitanya was very grave. He said, never speak like that. No, Lord Chaitanya didn't need a microphone. Never speak like that again. Whoever you meet, teach them about the beauty of devotional service. He taught them how to be the servant of the servant, compassionate toward others, and to always be taking shelter in Krishna's name. He said, if you just do this, there is no danger. There will be no distraction in living your life where you are and who you're with. And he said, and if you just do this, I will always be with you. He said, I will return to this place. In fact, I will never leave this place. I will always be with you. We will be together. If you just chant these names and share this blessing with us. And Lord Chaitanya the next morning, he left. That was a really good special effect. And what do you think Kurma Brahman did? He went with him. He followed him. And Lord Chaitanya said, go back. I've given you my order. Guru Bhana went back. And he was a completely pure devotee. He continued his occupation. He took care of his family. He stayed in his house. But he was a pure saint because he was chanting Krishna's names and he was living in a mood of servitude. And Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami said that was the instruction Lord Chaitanya gave to everyone, wherever he went in the sovereignty. Now, no doubt, there were some serious renunciates. He told Rupa Sanatana.
lead this bicycle to Vrindavan. He told Gopal Bhatta and Sri Rama, he said, serve your parents as long as they're living, and then, but don't get entangled in the meanwhile. And then when they leave this world, because they're great Vaishnavas, go to Vrindavan, join Rupa and Sanat, be a Goswami. But for some people, he actually inspired them to a life of renunciation, for the higher purpose of devotional service. But for most people, Lord Chaitanya instructed, just carry on with your duties in this world and put Krishna in the center by chanting his name and serving his devotees and being compassionate. That was the general principle of how we instructed almost everyone. One time in ISKCON, there was a serious conflict between the sannyasis and the grihasthas. It's quite famous, I'm sure you know about this. But basically, certain sannyasis were very empowered people. They were going to temples. Most of the temple presidents were grihasthas. And they were secretly preaching to the brahmacharis, you're not going to make any advancement serving under grihasthas. You should leave the temple and join us. And the brahmacharis, how could they refuse an offer like that from the famous sannyasi? So one grihastha president, he told me the story. He was the president of a serious temple in America. And the sannyasis came and were, you know, eating their food and preaching, and then they left. And when they left, all the brahmacharis all of a sudden were not there anymore. And how did they leave? They would tell them, they would say, you know, go out to distribute books at the parking lot like any other day. And we'll pick you up there. So just secretly bring whatever's valuable that you want to take with you and take it out for your book distribution today. We'll pick you up. And the brahmacharya will go out for distribution and never come back. And the president is going, where is he? Where is he? And then, like, some weeks later, they find out he's traveling on a bus with the sannyasis. So, anyways, this one president from the Boston temple. It's Riyasana. And, you know, all the brahmacharis go out. And by the time the sannyasis left, there was no brahmacharis left in the temple. So you know what he did? He called up the sannyasis and said, you know, there's nothing left here. Can I join you too? And they said, sure. So he joined the party too. Anyways, this was creating it wasn't such a cooperative effort. So the Grihastha's presidents complained to Srila Prabhupada, this is what these people are doing. And then the sannyasis were saying to Prabhupada, you know, we want to save these people, these brahmacharis, from the cycle of birth and death. So both were convinced that they were doing what Prabhupada wanted. Sannyasis convinced, yes, this is what Prabhupada wants. He wants the brahmacharis to really think the brahmacharis to do this. And the Grihastha says, well, we know that for sure Prabhupada wants them to maintain these temples otherwise. So it was in Mayapur. Where it is. Mayapur Festival. That it came to a culmination. The Grihasthas are talking to Prabhupada. Sannyasis are talking to Prabhupada. Each one convinced that they're right. And ultimately, they all had to accept what Srila Prabhupada was going to say. And almost everybody thought that Prabhupada was going to side with the sinners. Prabhupada totally took the side of the grihasthas.
Swami left everything to be a renunciate.
Nityananda Prabhu had two wives.
Everybody, even the greatest sannyasis, worshipped Advaita Acharya.
He had Sita Thakurani and six children.
Shivananda Sen, he had several children, a wife.
Srinivas Tagore had a wife, Malini.
And Lord Chaitanya was telling him, I am your family, I am your property.
Vasudev Dutt was the guru of the guru of Raghunath Das Goswami.
Vasudev Dutt was a grihastha. Raghunath Das Goswami was the crest jewel of renunciation.
Who's better?
They're both better. Not only are all better, they're all best. Because they were completely immersed in devotional service.
So Srila Prabhupada saw that his grihasthas were completely surrendering their lives to his loving service.
And they were perfect association.
And he sided with the grihasthas.
Told the sannyasis, give these people back to the temples and let them be there. This is my wish.
So what is renunciation?
Renunciation is not about changing our circumstance. It's about changing our hearts.
Sometimes among renunciates, there's an ego where people are fighting against each other.
And sometimes, again, grihasthas do the same thing.
Where there's the absence of that.
Where there's cooperation and a higher level of humility for the renunciation of our egos for the purpose of the mission. That's actual renunciation.
Political orientation toward materialistic politics to get our ways, backstabbing, dishonesty, that's just totally materialistic ego, that's all. You can decorate it in so many different garments and make it seem like it's pure devotional service.
The real renunciation means no tendency to find faults with us. No mundane political agenda. No ulterior motives.
Real renunciation is the desire to see everyone prosper,
while at the same time sticking to the Siddhanta.
And knowing well whether we have things or whether we don't have things. Nothing is ours. The beekeeper's going to come and take it all away. Maybe today. He may have done it yesterday. He's definitely going to come tomorrow. At the latest. So why should we be attached?
Srila Prabhupada explains false renunciation in so many ways.
He said one man, he has his wealth in a plate, and he's going home to enjoy it. And then a big wind comes, it blows it off the plate, and it's all in the air, and it's gone. And then, as it's in the air gone, he says, Krishna, I offer to you, I offer to you.
That's not true. We should offer it while we have it with love, not after it's taken away. We say, okay, Krishna, okay, it's yours. I'm so renounced.
King Pratapa Rudra was the king of Orissa, and he was renounced as any sannyasi because he used everything in Lord Chaitanya's service.
And Raghunath Das Goswami, what is the beauty of his renunciation?
He just thought everything should be for Krishna. Even when he took his diet, was enough buttermilk that fits in the palm of his hand, a little leaf cup of buttermilk. And while he would take it once a day, it would take him a couple seconds to drink this little leaf cup of buttermilk. He would be thinking, let's see how condemned I am. I'm wasting so much time just to enjoy my senses every day. He would imitate that. That's the way he was feeling. Everything belongs to Krishna. Every moment belongs to Krishna. How I should use every moment for Krishna. Some are eating nice prasad and they're thinking, I'm taking this prasad. Bhakti Vinod Thakur in his prayer. We take this prasad to our full satisfaction. But we're completely conscious that it's the gift of Krishna. It's the mercy of Krishna. And it's being used to energize us to serve Krishna. When that's our meditation, taking prasad is pure devotional service. That's one way of looking at it. But Raghunath was looking at it from another way. The time I'm spending eating, I'm wasting this time enjoying my senses. 3 seconds. What a perfectionist he was. He was bowing down minimum to 2,000 devotees every day. It was a regular principle. He would bow down to devotees 2,000 times a day. That means full dandanas. He would bow down to Krishna minimum 1,000 times a day. And he would chant at least 200,000 names of Krishna. And he would do parikrama over the hill every day. And it described he didn't have time to sleep more than at the most 1.5 hours a day. And many days he just didn't have time to even fit that in his yes. And yet, when he took those few seconds to drink the buttermilk, he was condemning himself. I'm wasting so much time. We can't imitate. That was the standard of his renunciation. If it could be like that, then that's another thing. But from Lord Chaitanya's perspective, she went on to say when he was working with his family in order to provide money for all the devotees to come to Bengal, was capturing his heart just as much. So we're reading here about Sita, who is the goddess of friendship. We can see it this way. I was just before class, by Krishna's grace, I was chanting japa in that other room, one next to the next room. Incredible paintings of Ramayana in that room. I think that's where we show movie projectors. There's a movie screen, there's just chairs. Those paintings of Ramayana, I've never seen them before. Sita sitting with Ram, and there's the golden deer that she's pointing. Ram, get me that deer. And Lakshman sitting a little distance, like, oh no. And then there's Gaura and Sita Ram after their exile in the forest and both crossing the Ganga. But anyways, I know the story. I wish I could give another class. Beautiful topics. But Suparnika Ram's sister fell in love with Ram and wanted to kill Sita so that she could enjoy Ram exclusively. And Lakshman, in order to protect Sita, cut off her nose. And I guess ladies from whatever dynasty you're in, you don't like people cutting off your nose. Because, you know, it's like some sort of plastic surgery. Cut off her nose. And she went back to Robin in Sri Lanka, and she wanted revenge, but she knew Robin as weakness. She wanted Sita to suffer. She's envious of Sita. She wanted to enjoy Ram, and Ram chose Sita over her. This was the time. Oh! Can't imagine her. It's burned with envy in her heart. Even when Ram, Ram said, I am married to Sita, I am faithful to her. Better you go with Lakshman. And then Lakshman said, but Ram's my older brother. If you come with me, you will have to be the servant of Sita. So Suparna's there with Sita standing between me and enjoying these beautiful men. She said, what is the use of your Sita? What is this woman? Look at her. Compare her to me. Look at how skinny she is. And look at the power of my arms. Look at that skinny, ugly little waist of hers. And look at mine. It's like a war drum. Power. And then Subhanaka, massive, powerful Rakshasa, she jumped at Sita. She was about to eat her flesh and drink her blood within a second. This was becoming serious. So Ram said, enough joking with this woman. Lakshman. So Lakshman. Nasik. The end of the place, Mustin's nose and seat needs to cut. So it used to be called Panchavati, which it still is. After this incident, I became Nasi. And so she went back to Robin. She wanted to get revenge on Ram because he didn't choose her, and she wanted to destroy Sita. So she told her, she knew Robin is weakness. He was, no matter how, he seemed ugly, he tells, that material enjoyment is like a fire. The more you feed it, the more it blazes. Greed, lust, lobha, kama. We're thinking it'll be satisfied if we get more, but actually it just aggravates the situation. Gita tells like a fire, the more fuel you put in by trying to satisfy it, the hotter and more hungry it becomes. And Prahlad describes it in another way. So trying to satisfy material desires, I like trying to satisfy an itch by scratching. Do you know what poison ivy is? Poison, I don't know what it's called. But it's a certain, like a leaf that's a reed. And if you do not touch it, you get a big rash. And it really, really itches. And if you scratch it, it makes it worse. The only way to get rid of it is you have to stop scratching. And it spreads. If you scratch it, you can like, and then you touch somewhere, then it grows here. When you accidentally touch here, it's sort of, what is it called here? You got that leaf here?
We don't have it.
We don't have it.
But you know when a child has it, because I have it. You know, you're playing in the forest, and you accidentally just touch it, and then all of a sudden this big rash, and it itches so bad. It just drives you crazy. And when you scratch it, it feels so good. It's like it's itching. And then you scratch it. But then when you stop scratching it, you have to keep scratching it harder and harder and harder, because as you're scratching it, it's becoming redder and redder and redder and more intense, and then it itches 10 times more after you scratch it. And then you try to scratch it again, even more enthusiastically, and as you're scratching, you just keep scratching and scratching. You can't stop scratching, you become addicted, like a scratch addict. It keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and more intense and itching, and then you stop and it's so when you're a little child, your parents tie your hands up. They tie your hands up so you can't scratch it. Because that's the only way you can let it. You have to tolerate it. There's a pink lotion called calamine lotion. You put it on. Kind of soothes it. But the only cure is to not scratch it. So you have to kind of tie your kids' hands, tolerate this. If you're an adult, nobody's going to tie your hands. Tolerate. Put some medicine on it. And then it goes away. And so Dr. Radhanath says all lust and all these desires for enjoyment are just like an itch. And trying to find relief from material suffering, and trying to enjoy lusty desires, is just like scratching the itch. Makes it worse. So rather than and because he had so much power and so much fame and so much wealth, he had so much ego, he was thinking, everything should be mine. You don't think about others, you just think everything is revolving around me. If I'm happy, then the universe is fine. If I'm not happy, then the universe is all wrong. That's what the ego does. Suparika started describing the beauty of Sita and the qualities of Sita. And she said, I wanted to bring Sita back for you to enjoy. Only for you, because I'm such a self-servant of you. Because I knew only you will be happy with the beauty and the charms of Sita are yours. But in the process of trying to bring Sita back to you, they cut off my nose. She definitely misrepresented the facts. Just by hearing about her, Ravana, she has to be mine. And he went to Maricha, who's a sage in the forest. And Maricha had already met Ram twice before and was defeated. And he was really afraid of Ram. He was living as a hermit in the forest, incognito, in fear of Ram. Subhabhu and Maricha were the two people who were disturbing Vishwamitra Muni's yagyas when Ram was just a little teenager. And Vishwamitra Muni brought Ram and Lakshmi. And when they came to harass the yagya, to Subhabhu,
Ram shot an arrow.
And that was the end of his life.
But from a rich Ram wanted to teach him a good lesson. Hit him in the chest. And Ram, when he wants to make an arrow, do something extraordinary. Just hear what happened. That arrow hit Maricha with such force that he flew back 800 miles.